Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for coming this evening on this really awful, never-ending winter evening. My name is Karen Campbell. I am the Phil Wilson Curator of Contemporary Art here at Joslyn and also the curator of the exhibition 30 Americans, of which this program is in celebration. So I'm going to say a few words about the show, and then I'm going to introduce this evening's host and MC and organizer, Felicia Webster. This is a really exciting program for us, and I think that this is kind of the start of something in terms of how we do exhibition-related programming at Joslyn, so thank you for being part of this experiment. So 30 Americans comes to us from the Rubel family collection in Miami. Don and Mira Rubel started collecting in the mid-1960s when they were living in New York City, and their collection grew in a very organic way. They would just sort of go for walks in their neighborhood, and maybe they would happen to meet an artist, and they would say, hey, can we come to your studio? And from there, they built one of the world's largest publicly accessible but privately owned collections of post-war art. And their collection happens to be particularly strong in work by artists of color. So in 2006, 2007, they started thinking about what this exhibition, 30 Americans, could be. They had had a number of conversations with younger African-American artists who were kind of just coming out of their MFA programs. And they learned that a lot of those artists were looking at an older generation of African-American artists like Jean-Michel Basquiat and Barclay Hendrix and Robert Colescott, who were all in the exhibition. And these were artists that Don and Mira had started to collect in depth already. So they saw this really kind of interesting intergenerational conversation happening, and then they started talking to some of those younger artists about what would it be to do an exhibition of all young Black artists or an intergenerational show of Black artists. What would that look like? How do we frame that? What kind of work do we include? And it kind of grew from there. And so they first staged the show in their Miami facility, which is a former DEA warehouse. It's kind of this great big brutalist building in the middle of a warehouse district. And that was in 2008. And then in 2011, the show started traveling in some capacity. But what's really great about it is that they don't treat it like a package show. So quite often when you take an exhibition from another place, you're kind of handed a stack of thumbnails and said, okay, here's the checklist for the show. This is how you're going to install it. Here's the didactic content. Here's even our recommendations for programming. But in this case, they really give presenting institutions carte blanche. So they have something like over 400 objects in this particular part of their collection. And from that, I chose about 65 objects by 30 artists to be our presentation of the show. And I really wanted it to fit both the needs of our space as well as the kind of needs of our audiences and what kind of stories we wanted to weave through this show. So it is intergenerational. The artists work across media, so you'll see, if you haven't been in the exhibition yet, I encourage you to. There's painting, sculpture, photography, video, works on paper. And this is a long overdue project for Joslyn. We have never had a major exhibition to exclusively feature the work of contemporary Black artists, and so when this opportunity came down the pike, we pretty quickly snapped it up. And we knew that we wanted programming to be integral to it. So again, thank you for being here. So I want to introduce this evening's co-producer and MC, Felicia Webster, who has been called the mother of spoken word poetry in Omaha. With the birth of the first spoken word open mics in the 90s, she has created and co-created safe spaces that give many poets, slam poets, def jam poets, wordsmiths, MCs, and storytellers platforms to share their souls. As an African-American performance poet herself, she has graced mics in Omaha and across the country. Felicia is not limited to the title poet, as she also wears the hats of businesswoman, mama, self-love coach, teaching artist, educator, radio and event host, and community activist. And her mission, as she lovingly says, is to, quote, offer healing through the power of the spoken word and connect others through the experience that the creative arts manifests. And we've been really lucky to work closely with Felicia, both on 30 Americans and on some other projects here at Joslyn. For this exhibition, for the first time, Joslyn developed a community advisory council, both to help us sort of with content and marketing and messaging, but also, perhaps most importantly, to help us think through what the most impactful and nuanced programming looked like. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Felicia Webster to the stage to kick off the night.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, beautiful beings, and those that love the creative arts. It is my pleasure to be here in this space and time with all of you. Because if it wasn't for you, we wouldn't have an audience. So please give yourselves a round of applause. When tasked with this particular project, I started to think, who could bring and manifest such powerful and dynamic words that would move, shift, and transform audiences if pulled together? Well, let me tell you, once, twice, three times, that I was able to work with and attract the most dynamic people here in Omaha, Nebraska, as it pertains to this particular exhibition. They are fierce, and that is just a simple adjective to describe the collective energy and the power of each one of the poets, performance artists, storytellers, wordsmiths, and just dynamic beings to come rock this night out with you. So we are going to get started, and I'm excited, but I'm going to leave you with some rules and, well, some expectations. If you feel the spirit of the works, you have permission to signify. Signify means that if your body responds by clapping, go ahead and clap, let's see you do it. Snapping, go ahead and snap. Golf clapping. Saying amen, say it.
Amen.
That's what's up.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have permission to do so. See, when it comes to showcasing poetry or being in a space where poetry is present, you feed the poet as the audience. And we need you. We cannot do it alone. So please, again, signify with love and passion, because you feed each and every person that is coming up here to share their works. Now, interestingly enough, I don't have my own program, so I need to borrow somebody's real quick. Keith, can I borrow yours? Thank you. We're also honored tonight to present Keith Rowe. He is an amazing DJ, recording engineer, producer out of Make Believe Studios right here in Omaha, Nebraska. He has worked with such acts as Beth, Wyclef, The Faint, Terrence Martin, Little Dragon, Derek Adams, DJ Spinna, Peanut Butter, Wolf, and many more. In 2012, he launched the record Make Believe Recordings with MBS founder Rick Carson, focusing on developing a core group of musicians from Omaha to produce video games, film, advertisement, and personal music endeavors. He is just an amazing DJ that you need to know. He's worked with our amazing boxer here, Terrence Crawford, and he continues to evolve in his craft, and he will create the soundscape of tonight's event. So please give it up for DJ Keith. Well, we're gonna kick this thing off with America, and I'm actually going to start. In my 20s, I memorized. And not that I still can't, but you know. Big ups to the younger generation. America. My people, and you claimed everything to be yours, calling it the norm. For spacious skies, for amber waves. cotton or soybeans, grain, tobacco, 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 cotton or soybeans. Maybe you forgot, but we were stolen from our homeland and stripped of our royalty. For purple mountains, majesty, the fruit to plants. And in plain sight, black folks are shot. And in plain sight, we are pulled over. And in plain sight, y'all ticket us at barbecues. And in plain sight, you say that we are suspect. And in plain sight, we can't go to playgrounds. And in plain sight, we can't use our minds. And in plain sight, we can't go to church. And in plain sight, cookouts look worse. America. America. God shed his grace on thee and me and my beautiful black magic and my people. And we didn't start off as slaves, so I'm so getting tired of you always saying that that's where our history started, but that was just a portion of our journey in this lifetime. See, there's something about don't shoot. And crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining. And that's why we kneel. Thank you. Our next poet to come rock the mic is none other than Jewel Rodgers. She is an American speaker, poet, and content creator from North Omaha, Nebraska. She finds most interesting the dichotomy between urban economics and building an environment as it relates to social norms that form in our communities. Through her work, she aims to arouse curiosity, diligence, and connectedness through many forms of communication. Rodgers' work tonight is inspired by Basquiat's Bird on the Money. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Jewel Rodgers.
Tired bird could fly, bird, high bird in the sky soaring. I heard the phoenix flies after it burns. Heard he had ashes for wings. Light on my feet, it feels good. The wind used to accompany me like sunset with the perfect midsection. The saxophone would shine like star eyes. Now it just screams. I holler back at it as long as I can. You see, no, you and I, we've got something in common. We can fly. Your cape looks a lot like mine. And they think we're superheroes. I say we're kings. Too accustomed to flight to know what it means when the cape wraps around your neck instead of the night air. So you and I both know what it means to be a legend too fragile for this body. You too have known pain. You too have known bloodied wing. Tired bird could fly, bird, high bird in the sky soaring. Why is it so lonely to be this high in these clouds? Are these clouds yellow sunshine, smile, busyness in the body is busyness in the streets? The cityscape was alive and tired, ain't have much detail for a reason. See, they declared us kings before we even had a kingdom. The village of the illegal mind bears an intoxicating thing, sweet nectar too far to reach. I have fallen from the nest. I wonder if they know that rosy color toward his torso means something. Silver spoon sickness on his feathers. Powder, puff, powerful, still trying to find the records from the time they say I lost my mind. My mother knows, much like I know, the pigment of your wing, your vein on display. Power positions the poison, and still he could fly, bird, sky high, bird, as high as they'd let him. As high as they let me. You see, I wanted the crown. I knew it was heavy.
Cut.
Perhaps this is also a self-portrait.
372, take 11.
Just Buddy got a 4-bar intro.
A reflection of many things.
I got 5 chords.
Cut out, take 11.
372, take...
Yard bird turned. Blue bird turned. Blue bird turned blue, bird turned victor. Suppose he was a man that, in search for longevity, became slave to the creative mind. This is not in praise of the poison, he would say. Waiting for ideas to fly by, bird, by, bird, high in the sky, soaring. A man once told New York Times that John knew flight better than most. Said John had the silver spoon sickness. Said John could fly, but he chained himself to goldwood, greenwood, pheasant shooters demanding flight of his bones even after plucking the feathers, and soon he would demand flight of his bones even after plucking the feathers. Why can't I pin back on these feathers? Why they name the palace after me but never give me no crown? Obsessed with attaining flight. Resentful of the scorching heat so close to the sun, convinced the only way to creativity was to burn out amidst the flames, I made my own crown. And I wasn't slave to it in the ways they say I should have been, and it felt good. Hi, bird. Billy, Janice, Jimmy, Charlie Parker, you see, birds like these knew the feathers never really touched the body. Birds like these knew skin turned water could always keep you from drowning. Birds like these knew what it meant to lose flight and still have to be birds. Still find your flight. Still wear the wings. Perhaps this is also a self-portrait.
Come on.
A reflection of what become. This must be death by greenwood, by concrete village, by darkness of the deep moving across the water. Jean declared the light was good. We all went home when the show was over, when the curtain closed, when the sun went down, when the light was out. Well, tell me, how much am I worth now? How high can I fly now? You see, bird on money is the story of a lifetime that only lasted a moment. In the end, you could see that the moment cost him a lifetime. You can see the bloodshot blue in his eyes. You can see he is no longer flying. He is standing. He is grounded. He is chained. You can see he has known what it means to die before death itself arrives. Why are your heart so black, bird? Where are your wings, Jean? Victor. Angel. Even with the 59-cent halo, what an angel, what a genius child, what an overworked wing. Only half of me is clean. He fell again, they call out. What an angel, we say. If that's what it takes, he says, to be king. crown is sharp. The crown is sharp for a reason. Most young kings get their heads cut off. Question is, who's done the cutting? You see, this piece was not meant to be a happy one. They will say it was his fame that killed him. I think it had more to do with his astute awareness of his own mortality. He wants to know what it means to burn out. He wants to know what it means to shine. He can get no closer to the sun than this. He still tries. I can tell you, he knows what it means to be burned. To be burned in flight. Shine your light, they say. You see, Jean was a candle in the wind, and still, and still, he could push back the wind. And we'd flock around his ashes to attend a funeral lifetimes in the making. Every painting was the casket and the flowers. No wonder the fume was so beautiful when you began to bloom. The pages still pressed fresh in our history books. Sean, you beautiful vessel, it's been ages. We've brought for you a different tale. The prince is king now, a head amidst the alluring I love you was an adornment that perverted the sight of your own beauty to your blinding light in a manner that could not compel the people at the party to love you. Not in the way you knew you needed to be loved to survive. The money looks a lot like the city, a lot like the buildings and the people within them. You see, we are the people within them. We all hated to watch you take flight, but couldn't help but love to watch you soar. You see, this composition is in remembrance of Jean in another lifetime, when he was also bird, when he was still with bloodied wing and crisp collar, and even when he was low, he could fly sky high, declaring his own kingdom, creating his own crown, pinning together his wings. You see, money can be many things. That is the interpretation of Bird on Money. Thank you.
Thank you, Jewel. What a wonderful rendition of Basquiat through her eyes. Next, we have poet Alan Stevenson, who has been involved in poetry for 20 years and over time has embraced the art of spoken word and storytelling. Stevenson examines personal experience through poetry and uses his art to uplift others who may be challenged by difficult circumstances. He enjoys sharing his stories to make people think about their current surroundings and climate. With his talents, Stevenson gives back to the community, especially touching younger audiences and encouraging them to tap into their own gifts. Stevenson lives in Omaha with his wife and five children and occasionally hosts poetry events. You can catch this artist around the town at different open mics. Tonight, Alan Stevenson will give us a rendition that was inspired by Noah Davis's Painting for My Dad. Alan Stevenson.
As I stand here looking over the edge, sometimes I feel like I'm trapped between a rock and a hard place, the rock. The blood of John Crawford screams from the Walmart floor and tells me they didn't give him a chance. Tamir's toy will never be played with again. Sean Bell missed his wedding date, and Botham John wasn't even able to sit at home, and I'm confused. Am I trapped inside of America's echo chamber as she cries, I don't see color? Or am I losing a whole lot of brothers that look a little darker than the shooters? Homes are being broken, pastors quoting scriptures, and scores of people are looking at Jesus and becoming a little more skeptical. Some will say this is part of his plan. Dylan Roof will tell you otherwise. You mean to tell me that in a place that's supposed to be the most secure and bring me nothing but peace, I gotta look out for the next mass shooter and consider packing a piece? Sandra Bland goes into jail with functioning lungs, left in a plastic bag. Eric was trying to tell them that he couldn't breathe. They didn't stop until he did. Walter Scott caught shots in the back because, you know, we really show our highest threat potential when we're unarmed and running away. Philando told the cop that he had the tool tucked away, and he was dropped in the process of cooperation. Come on. Am I supposed to look at my son in the face and say that everything will be okay if you cooperate? The hard place. Their forefathers have built well-oiled machines that run off of my desperation. Knowing that I need this money to feed my sons and daughters, but trading time for money isn't economically savvy, but this table isn't going to set itself. I feel like I'm trapped in a bad geometry problem because I was hoping that I could try another angle, but when I go around these circles, I still somehow feel boxed in. Being sold the American dream without enough coins for the down payment.
Come on.
I guess that's why we spend life working and then risk life to obtain the pie. Dashing across the gun line when she sets it outside. Eat organic. Bet. I'm on it. But then I have to double the price I pay for a gallon of milk, two eggs, and some apples. Do I really need this organic stuff, or will regular food do? Choices no parent should ever have to come to. And I am told that my vote is my voice. But I have been screaming at the top of my lungs, no to more walls, because I have been systematically surrounded my entire life by octagons. And the very thing that I voted against is trying to build a structure with money that our country technically doesn't have. And I am given the freedom of speech until I say something that you don't like.
Come on.
Then it's sit down and don't fight like that. Get up off of one knee because all lives matter, so act right. I promise you I will. As soon as you clean up Flint's pipes and share some of that tax money that you're making off of weed with some of the inmates that got locked up for having a couple of grams of it 7 years ago.
Come on.
Intel from COINTELPRO and Fred Hampton's bloody bed tells the tales of your not so greatly kept secrets. Yes. What would Malcolm's chest truly say if it could speak about the Audubon ballroom? What nigga dug into whose pockets? The greatest of my ancestors have put food on your tables for generations, and with all of the cuts that we suffered, you got the nerve to wrinkle up your face when I asked for my cut of the profits? We were told to consult with our prophets. Be nice. Pray. While you prayed on our backbones to prop up your lands like those beautiful pillars on your ironically titled colonial homes. Y'all might have missed that.
Come on.
Titled colonial, AKA take over your home.
Come on.
Some of my people were given early caskets. Which one of yours took it like Emmett because they thought that a black woman was pretty? To hell with your jury selection and the coke y'all drank and the card games y'all played, only to come back and say not guilty. I have been furious with way more than five of you, and I warned you not to push me closer to this edge, but yet, here I am. Staring down the stars is one choice, and the unknown as another. What if the only thing down there is more of your taunts? I mean, numbers don't lie, but you've lied about the numbers. Some of my people were told that if we get to this position and jump, then the sky would catch us. But they left off that little violent caveat about the part where you tie the rope around our neck to send us there. I mean, what if I go from being trapped between a rock and a hard place to being trapped between concrete and a steel beam? What if I lose everything? Yeah, I serve a God that sits high and looks low, but could he really see what's down there? Would he really catch me if I jump? Is it he who lifts my head when I slump? Had I been a weaker man, I would have just turned around and walked away and wept and suffered from the doubts of my father, but I see the stars. And I see what victory looks like. Knowing that sticks and stones, AKA bullets and chains, will not stop me from reaching the heights of the glory that my God has set before me. Yes, I have asked him questions, and he has given me the answers. Faith without works is dead. And trust, I know how to get my hands dirty, because I have constantly wrestled with the stains of what you tell me cannot happen. Darkness doesn't scare me. Standing on this cliff and doing nothing does.
Alan Stevenson. It's getting hot in here. It is, with truth. And that's the only way that we can be here in front of you is to speak our truths. It's when you speak your truth that you convey a message to someone else who needed to hear it, who needs to heal through it, who needs to transform through it, who needs to hear how stories are told through the spoken word. Our next amazing poet is none other than Michelle Troxclair. She is a poet and spoken word artist in the African American oral tradition. She is a community activist, arts advocate, and for more than 40 years has written poetry. She has widely published in literary magazines and anthologies. Troxclair works with the Nebraska Writers Collective and is currently overseeing work with incarcerated youth at Douglas County Youth Correctional Center and with young people at Blackburn Alternative High School. She emphasizes the powers of words and the value of their voices and experiences. She uses her platform to speak truth to power and to shine light in dark places. With that in mind, she launched her own nonprofit organization, Verse, with a mission to make poetry exciting and relevant for future generations. She is also an advocate for her community and arts through her radio show, Michael and Michelle in the Morning, on Mind and Soul 101.3 FM. Tonight, Michelle's performance is inspired by Leonardo Drew's sculpture, Untitled, 25.
Again, like Fee said, when we were in our 20s, we could memorize. And since I made 50,
yes,
I'm the grandma here in the group. I would like to think that, well, my brain would like to think that this is memorized, but we may know better. Whoa, jump down, turn around, pick a bale of cotton. Jump down, turn around. Pick a bale of cotton. Excuse me, miss. Yes, you. That's a lovely blouse you're wearing. It looks so soft and so comfortable. Why, yeah, thank you. It's 100% cotton. Oh, there appears to be a stain there, though. Right there on your sleeve. That would be the blood spatter of Joseph when he received 7 lashes on his back. Mm. 7 lashes for 7 bags he came up short. Mm. 1 lash for 1 bag for not meeting his quota. Yes, 7 stripes. Mm. And he saw 7 stars. Mm. And as that blood flew
we all knew that we would bear the scars. Mm. So jump down, turn around, pick a bale of cotton. Jump down, turn around, pick a bale of cotton. Mm. I see you got another stain there on the other sleeve. That would be the sweat from Millie's forehead, see? Mm. Yes, as she stooped over in a field in 98-degree heat. Mm. With 90% humidity. Mm. Picking row after row after row. In fields of white that look like dried snow. Mm. She swiped her brow, wishing for one sip of water. Mm. Just one sip of water. Mm. Yeah, she swiped her sleeve across her brow and dust and salt are there now. Mm. And all she got to taste was her cracked lips. Mm. And her sorrow. So jump down, turn around, pick a bale of cotton. Jump down, turn around, pick that bale of cotton. There's one left. One last stain, and I'm sorry, it's right down there in the front. You might not be able to see it in this light, but it's there. Mm. Those would be the tears shed by young Liza there. Yes, young Liza. Her fingers ripped and torn from those thorns from that wretched plant. Her head pounding, joints ache, twisted back, feet swollen in that heat. She was with child, and waves of nausea did creep. Mm. And her tears began to fall, but no one heard her cries. Not with the biting mosquitoes and the buzzing of those flies. And the baby dies. Jump down, turn around, pick a bale of cotton. Jump down, turn around, pick a bale. The touch, the feel of cotton, the fabric of our lives. The touch, the feel. Of cotton, the fabric of our lives. Thank you. Woo!
Yeah. Woo! Yes. Yes. Ooh, hallelujah. Mm. I told you they were bad. That's bad meaning good, just in case you didn't know. Our next poet is Ryan Boyland. He is a writer and wanderer currently based out of Omaha, Nebraska. And after studying neurobiology and astrophysics in college, his love for both science and poetry motivated him to combine the two at every opportunity. His work addresses the issues of identity, love, and death, and stars, because they're cool. His goal through performance is to touch the minds and hearts around the world and considers it a victory every time he is able to do so. Boylan has already left his mark on stage, earning a spot on the Omaha National Poetry Slam team, as well as winning the Poetry Slam in both the city of Omaha on an international level and an individual World Poetry Slam in both 2018. Ryan serves as a teaching artist with the Nebraska Writers Collective, where the amazing works of his students constantly warms his cold, cruel heart. When he is not writing, Ryan enjoys listening to music, stargazing, and being Black, mixed in with an occasional intense discussion regarding the validity of the Star Wars prequels. Tonight, Boylan is responding to Gary Simmons' Duck, Duck, Noose. Ryan Boylan.
Duck, 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 noose. It sounds like something we teach our school children. There's a surprising darkness lying on the other side of nursery rhymes. Ring Around the Rosie was about the Black Plague. Humpty Dumpty was about some dead French king. Mm. Some say Eeny, Meeny, Miny, Moe was about an escaped slave. And yet, we, children, naive and happy, sang it all the same. Mm. One. In Montgomery, Alabama, there was a massive shelf line with dozens of jars of soil taken from lynching sites. From the corner of the room, I hear a voice asking me why we can't let the past be the past. I cannot forget what I never remembered. Mm. Over 4,000 Black people were lynched between 1877 and 1950. I can only name two. The jars are labeled with names I have never known. They rattle with stories and screams never heard, echoes of bodies left dancing in the autumn breeze, a message, a lesson, a warning. Duck, 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 noose. Mm. Strange fruits swinging from the poplar trees made strong by that black down south dirt, dirt, heavy with blood, salty with tears, trembling with laughter. See, these lynchings were family affairs. Mm. A field of faces split wide in joy, comfortable enough here so that they left their white hoods at home. Bring a picnic basket and make a day of it. Teach the kids a song while they're here. Duck, 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 noose. Mm. Two. When the schools were desegregated in 1956, children born of cornbread and collard greens were sacrificed in the name of equality. Mm. Shepherded into schools by the US Army like black sheep fit for the slaughter. First, they offered up a six-year-old girl as tribute. Reporters asked where Ruby Bridges got all of her strength, and she answered them with a scripture and a song. Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. And I wonder what Ruby's father felt, if Ruby's father felt like Abraham. In one hand holding a knife, in the other a proud apology, a child ready to forgive. Where no forgiveness is earned, Abraham, or Abron Bridges, told to decide between his child and his freedom, Abraham, or Abron praying for a ram in the bush or someone else's daughter, anything with the pulse to suffer in that child's place. And when Ruby came back, still black, still breathing, the crowds were still thirsty for blood and we had none to offer except more of our own. In Little Rock, on September 23rd, 1957, nine black students armed with only school books and book bags faced a crowd of their classmates, still children themselves, porcelain faces turned red with hate and no one asked where they got it from. Mm. These children spread their machine gun mouths wide and fired into the air, hoping to hit anything with too much melanin. Duck, 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 noose. Mm. I was asked why I don't just get over it. Because Ruby Bridges is younger than my grandmother. Mm. Little Rock Central High School is right down the block from her house. This history is only a phone call away. The distant past lives beneath an oak tree in a home she's had since the 1970s. This wound is too fresh, the pain too near the surface. I feel it every time I fold my grandmother in my arms. Desegregation was never enough recompense. The Civil Rights Act was a payment past due. We're still waiting to collect the interest. Another lamb is an insufficient sacrifice. I want a mule, 40 acres, a head. Three, Jeff Brown, 1916, Cedar Bluff, Mississippi, for accidentally bumping into a white girl as he tried to catch a train. Jesse Thornton, 1940, Laverne, Alabama, for failing to address a police officer as Mr. Luther Holbert, 1904, Doddsville, Mississippi. Mrs. Holbert, 1904, Doddsville, Mississippi. A white landowner was found dead. Holbert and his wife were tied to a tree and tortured. Their fingers were cut off and distributed to the crowd as souvenirs. Men, women, and children with skin like porcelain watched while eating deviled eggs, drinking lemonade, sipping whiskey. Duck, 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 noose. Four, I was 8 when I first learned a tongue can crack like a whip. A porcelain skinned boy told me to go pick him some cotton. He opened his mouth and stole my voice. The silence I left behind still haunts me. I was 14 when a boy painted the Confederate flag on the back of his truck and drove it to school every day. No one asked where he got all of his hate. Racism is easy to learn when it's taught alongside our ABCs. I was 15 when a girl told me her father hated the idea of her with a black boy. Her solution, she wanted me to take her to the school dance to see the look on his face. To her, my life was simply a joke, something to be laughed at while her father polished his gun in the next room. It's funny how things never seem to change. Black folks dying for entertainment. I was 16 when a girl told me she would never be with a black boy because, quote, you're all too aggressive. I was 17 when a girl told me she would never take me home to her parents because her uncle was in the Klan, and she laughed. To her, the Klan was just another part of the family. The silence I left behind still haunts me to this day. Racism is the boogeyman haunting the American dream. That night, my nightmares were filled with burning crosses and lynch mobs. I woke and did not know who to blame for my death. Was it the man who tied the knot? The crowd who cheered? The girl who stood by and watched? My mother for birthing me? Myself for believing the skin to be anything but a target? Duck, 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 noose.
Thank you, Ryan. And I want to give Ryan a special shout out. I actually just reached out to him 2 days ago. He picked his piece. He got all the materials in for Susie and myself, and here he is. So thank you so much. Thank you for sharing that. Thank you. Everybody, please take a deep breath. Inhale love, exhale hate. Paula Bell was born in East St. Louis, Illinois, but has lived in Omaha for most of her life. She graduated from the University of Nebraska at Omaha with a bachelor's degree in business administration. Paula began writing spoken word poetry 9 years ago as a way to cope with life challenges, overcome shyness, manage her fear of speaking in public, and gain self-confidence. In 2002, she accepted an invitation to join the Wordsmiths, a professional spoken word African-American troupe who edutains through prose, poetry, and storytelling using the African-American oral tradition. Paula is passionate about breast cancer awareness and is positively impacting younger generations. She enjoys listening to music, dancing, writing, and spending time with friends and family. Tonight, Paula was inspired by Miss Mutu's mixed media piece, and I hope I say this right, Nanja Ni Reget Rien. Paula Bell.
She is fine.
We didn't learn how to talk until we were taught. We didn't learn how to walk until we were shown. We didn't learn our black is majestic until we were told. We didn't learn hate of self until white privilege influenced us that our mother of skin, our spiraled architecture, the deity in our kinks, the style of our diction was too dark, too curvy, too nappy, to be beautiful. To acknowledge our beauty was to acknowledge our humanity and downgrade their privilege. So they declassed us, carved the goddess out of our universe, molded tongues from native to foreign, tamed beasts out of our roots, waged war against us and our melanin. They considered our bodies as vile, but they continued to force their way into our rites of passage over and over and over again, reminding us that that was their property too. We shape-shifted, bounced languages between codes, blended forbiddens in cuisines and hymnals, danced under the phases of the moon, touched the compass under wings of doves so we, our children, and our children's children could find their way home. So how in the hell did we wind up back on the auction block again? Selling out ourselves. We fell asleep on our consciousness, hungered and thirst after righteousness of a system that demonized us, a system that we prepared food for but couldn't sit at the table with.
Come on.
We dipped our souls in mainstreams, troubled waters, but our past was too black to pass, and a past is required to swim in those pools. They beat us with 40 lashes of insecurities and unraveled the stenches of our progress. It's no wonder that we are falling apart. We deconstructed our blackness to fit their taste, from our hair down to our shadows. We bent over, permitted them to examine our de-racialization, sold our ebony to the highest bidder. The traits we repudiate, the privileged appropriate. They pay docs to play gods. They pay docs to play gods, stretch lips to protrusion, remanufacture frames into figure eights, rearrange faces into forgeries. But impression without oppression is a bold-faced lie.
Come on, Paula.
No matter how we alabaster bleach our skin, pass brown paper bag test, we cannot fade dark from our history. Our black blood drops rule the impersonations by one. Our ancestors are buried in our bones. Our backs bend at our hemisphere. Our lips confess our struggles and our successes. Tongues excavate voices buried in unmarked graves in the history America tries to forget. We may be broken, but the Creator shapes brokenness into masterpieces. His might has touched us in gold, wrapped our bodies in skin deep beauty, shaded our complexion in melanin. We walk on galaxies, we are goddesses. But history has a way of repeating itself. We didn't learn how to talk until we were taught. We didn't learn how to walk until someone showed us. We didn't learn that our black is majestic until our black is majestic.
Yes. Yes. Paula Bell. Tyrone Harper is originally from New Jersey and has lived and worked in Omaha for the most part of the past 20 years. He started writing poetry at a young age and has always had a love for words. Harper has performed at spoken word poetry events for over 10 years. Beginning as an original member of the Wordsmiths, a local dynamic, dope poetry troupe. Currently, Harper is working on projects with the Black Love Collector, the Black Love Collective, which is founded by me, and he has traveled and performed all over Nebraska and as far as North Carolina. He believes in the power of words and desires to speak with fire, passion, and courage of his ancestors whose shoulders he stands on. Tonight, he is inspired by Kendall Wiley's painting, Sleep.
Sleep, young man, but remain awake. Sleep, young man, but remain awake. When even your dreams appear as nightmares and fear, I know you scared. It's hard to close your eyes through them tears, these rain-soaked windows to your soul. Rest is at best restless and quietness, ears sensitive to small ticks on the wristwatch. Your eyes watch the ceiling. The clock, count the jumping flock, the news, nothing's new, facing the same situation even before you. Something's real strange about that fruit. Something's real strange about that fruit. Something is real strange about that fruit. Eerily swinging there, it's crystal clear, even in darkness, that silhouette is you. Appearing lifeless in the quietness, but the silence is about to be shattered like glass from high-pitched screams. It seems I see movement. I see movement, life in your body, breath escaping your chest, the attempts to kill you by those who suppose the attempts to kill you would actually kill you have actually made you stronger. So sleep, young man, but remain awake. Sleep. Young man, but remain awake. The scripture says you will dream dreams as a boy and a teen, see visions at a time when your vision's disappearing and your eyes are squinting and you struggling to see the road. Clear is the one your ancestors were forced to run, understanding they were paving one with an understanding you would come. Understanding you would need them, their direction. The direction and guidance, their fearlessness and wiseness, strength to be wild and violent when the situation's requirements required. No more diplomacy, sitting down at the table quiet, praying for assimilation into an unwilling society, looking skyward, looking forward towards a savior breaking through the chariot of fire. God gave you the power, an internal riot marching through the streets of your vessels and bones. You've been called to take this role long before you were even born. And I know you. I know you didn't ask for this. You question which method is the best amidst this madness which has plagued your blackness since ships arrived on the shores of West Africa. Sleep, young man, but remain awake. Sleep, young man, but remain awake. For your soul's sake, for the souls of those tossed overboard, left floating in the ship's wake, the soul's sake of your fellow shipmates, for the soul's sake of the future yous, who's yet to make the very first journey through fallopian tubes, waiting to break through mama's womb, only to be introduced to a cold, cold world. It is a cold, cold world. But you can burn it. So burn this shit up. So burn this shit up with the fire in your gut, the fire in my gut. Sleep, young man, but remain awake. Sleep, young man, but don't close your eyes too long. Don't close your mind at all. Be the cause and the subsequent effect. Be the problem and the solution. Make them bring cameras to the revolution. Snapchat clips of what you doing. Hashtag what the sleeping woke are doing. You're trending, viral, spreading like wildfire, and I know you tired. I know you tired. I'm tired. Your body, my body, endured the same pain. Your eyes, my eyes have seen the same thing. Your mind, my mind, built to sustain. Your head, my head, sits comfortably the rain. Sleep, young man, but remain awake for your soul's sake, for our soul's sake. Sleep, but remain awake to best affect the change. Thank you very much.
I don't think anybody is asleep now. Stay woke. Elizabeth is a multi-talented community activist and visionary who has been creating and communicating poetically since she was a youth. A native Omahan raised among creative artistic family and community involved history lovers, Elizabeth is a collaborator of her passions, and she allows that to guide her life. The artist has performed her original works and accompanied with dance interpretation for local events such as the Moving Company Salon and Looms Weaving the Social Fabric Through Dance. She has performed for cultural events at the University of Nebraska at Omaha, the Malcolm X Foundation, and a variety of events citywide and throughout the country. She is humbled to share her life force with the community through poetic movement and meditation as a certified Thai yogi, yoga practitioner, and Ayurvedic energy movement therapeut. You know what? I'm about to mess this word up. I'm gonna say therapist. She delights in being a mother of three, of Omaha youth, and a community auntie to many, advocating knowledge of self and empowerment through self-love. Tonight, Elizabeth is inspired by Thomas's Hotter Than July. Elizabeth.
Either, so
that's all right.
And I appreciate being dug up too. I ain't been up here in a while. They said if he came back home, we could not stay. So I hid his clothes and his shoes before the inspection. He set out down 24th Street. The spaces between his vertebrae spontaneously adjusting, snow crunching under his feet, mind in a blaze, cold air teasing his eyes while he drifted into the next dimension, envisioning things that he would build one day. Passion, hotter than July. Empty spaces in his pride, though, burnt out, reflecting the hole between the barbershop and the corner store. A hole that was once a black business, but that was before he was born. Now all that remains are the ghosts of black economics. Empty lot after empty lot, reminiscent of the unfinished lives of the likes of Vivian. But he was strong, for he too was a drug war veteran. Yet he knew he carried greatness in his ancient genetic signature. History told them they were less than men. And that if they were indeed the first, that the theory must be valid. Because how could the ancients have been intellectually advanced? Theories handed down like family heirlooms, but we would be different. I watched him walk until he was a blur in the distance. He went with his head up like Malcolm, fearless like Edward and David. The smell of this rising sweet rice still in the air. A faint breeze crept in through the window, through the crack around the window. But my chi flowed over me, warm and electric, see, he was a healer. To him, distance was a thing never to mind, and separateness was merely an illusion. There was nothing that could prevent our spiritual communication. It's fundamental. Intimate overtones that make my heartstrings sing on the second and fourth harmonic, the amplitude of his energy making my blood rush to creativity's rhythm. That night, he lay his head on my stomach, tucked his hands under my back. Warm tears flowed like ink over the sides of me, penning his story in silent heart vibration. He's a warrior. And me, I am an alchemist. In his presence, I can be all that I am. No shifting, no makeup, no mask, no costume. They said if he came back home, we couldn't stay. I'm power in my own right, and he is my balance.
Thank you.
Therapetician, that was the word, you guys. I just kind of grazed over that. Please give it up for Elizabeth. We're down to the last five wordsmiths, poets, performance artists, and I just want to ask you, how are you doing? Well, let's get this thing moving. Olivia Johnson hails from North Omaha and wishes to aid our community as we navigate through the old and new days of systematic racism and oppression. A believer that performance art often channels expression, Olivia has represented the Omaha spoken word community on a local and national stage with tenacity, grace, and fire. Persevering over social roadblocks, Olivia is a champion of self-acceptance, individualism, and accountability. Tonight, she is inspired by Xavier Simpson's One Day Back Then. Olivia Johnson.
Sitting in the morning sun, I'll be sitting when the evening comes, watching the ships roll in, and I'll watch them roll away again. Hey, black girl, why ain't you smiling? Maybe because My black doesn't fit your definition of happy.
Mm, come on.
Hey, black girl, why you ain't making us laugh? Maybe because my black isn't funny.
Mm, come on, Olivia.
Hey, black girl, why you ain't got no kids? Maybe because my black isn't mammy incarnate. And maybe because I'm tired. Tired of standing for ideals that were never mine. All this racist messy, yes, it was just best to retreat. Be one with my divinity. Being one to openly heal ancestral wounds properly and lovingly. It was best to retreat because where I was heading, slipping and spinning into a black hole of an existence that again was never mine and where blind faith couldn't reach me.
Come on.
It was best to relearn how to see. Best to relearn how to dance the that was beaten out of we of the African sun. Where we knew the dance of life. We knew how to tap our toes, swirl these hips, and our arms would embrace heart. We moved by ancient wisdom, not of bondage, of broken wounds, of lacked backs. It was best to retreat because this world just ain't ready for me. Where I could be one with my divinity, where I could be as black as I wanted to be without any apology.
Come on. Yes.
Because you see, nothing really changes. Everything still remains the same. And I can't do what 10 people tell me to do, so I guess I'll just remain the same. Sitting here resting my bones, this loneliness won't leave me alone.
Come on, Olivia.
2,000 miles I've roamed just to make this spot my home.
Yeah. Can you see why it was such a blessing? I have to use that word blessing to put this dynamic group of people together. Olivia Johnson. Next up, we have Damon Lamont Caldwell, better known among wordsmiths as Mr. Dame Poetry. He began writing poetry in high school and has been performing for several years now. Caldwell was a member of the 2017 Omaha Slam team and continues to be involved with creative groups throughout the city. He served in the United States Army for 7 years and deployed to Iraq as a combat medic. Today, Caldwell is an electrician by profession. He is an artist, though, by nature. Tonight, his work is inspired by Kerry James Marshall's vignette number 10. Please welcome Mr. Dame Poetry.
Hello. I'm nervous. Give yourselves a round of applause for being here. This will be a variation of You Are Enough for Me. I've never needed the view of a dozen beautiful trees, 100 feet high, outside of my window. Only the wind and skies at night, you remember? You used to be enough for me. But I still dreamed of houses with high ceilings and chandeliers like theirs, always comparing. I wanted cars like theirs, always comparing, without considering the ceiling that I'd fall under and how fast I'd go to get to the bottom. I'm sorry, I never considered the bigger picture of this whole life and love thing. I've never needed the ballroom attire either, or the ballrooms for that matter, for gathering our guests. Our company was always sufficient. We knew it, and so did they, I suppose, those insiders outside of us that envied us, that somehow we envied as well. We couldn't have longed for something as temporary as the promotion and profits of losing this moment, and losing this space doesn't promote us to greater heights or profit us at all. See, we lost momentum dancing with our minds, entangled with our thoughts, but I wouldn't be caught dead dancing without you. Take my hand, so that the next time I forget, you can bring me here to remind me, to remind myself what I am to you, what our love stands for. You see, we painted it to make it pretty for who? Dressed it up to make it look cool for a few, paraded around, now it's facades and frowns, and we hate it for making it what it was never intended to be. It was our love, it's still our love. You are still enough for me. See, I wanted to say you are enough for me. But when I gathered up the confidence to greet you, you didn't let me speak. Something about the complexity of you, me. Excuse me. Something about the complexity of us men. Sorry.
That's all right. That's all right.
I wanted to say you are enough for me. But when I gathered up the confidence to greet you, you didn't let me speak. Something about the complexity of us black men, plus your experience places the best of us in the wrong bunch, thus causing me to be defeated before I can even ask if you're free tomorrow for lunch. So excuse me, my black queen, if I may. Allow me to restore your faith in a man in these mannerisms that you've come to hate, but you stand for them, and most men can't stand it either, though it's not so great. Look here, queen, I won't let you stand for it any longer. You deserve to see the sunrise of a team, a king and a queen, and set on your dreams dawning. Get stronger together.
Come on.
Explore progression. Teach each other's life's lessons so that through learning you and learning me, there won't be any need for any exceptions. We'll know each other that well, and when we're off, we'll address it same day mail. When it's time to giddy up and go, we'll both know there's no concession. I think that's fair. Black men do seek that sort of fulfillment, that sort of commitment, you dig? See, I wanted to say, queen, you are enough for me, and understand and overstand that I don't apologize for the acts of the past or the last man, because from where I stand, I am past that. And the last man, I won't let you say sorry for anything not relative to now. There's nothing to forgive, and to recklessly dig isn't who I am. I mean, dig that if you can. But queen, I intend to treat this like my first reel. This is my first reel. I said my first reel, last chance at love and serenity and being happy and all that other mushy stuff that I ain't well versed at yet. But I'll rehearse that for our sake. I wanted to get this message across to you. You are enough for me.
When making an oops becomes the most powerful part of the piece. Mr. Dame Poetry. Ooh, all right. I'm about to call you Ty. Ty Davis is artistically no one. Her style is a combination of hip-hop cipher and slam poetry. Through wordplay, she blurs the lines between written and oral presentation. And she wrote a short bio, because we could go on and on until the break of dawn about Ty, but I'm just gonna let you have the experience. Tonight, she is inspired by Rodney MacMillan's Untitled. Ladies and gentlemen, beautiful beings and all energies, welcome to the stage, Ty Davis.
I love you. Anybody got an iPhone? When you're like writing notes, if you accidentally delete that note, can you like just go back in and undelete it? Bro, you dope. Thank you so much.
We are the world. I'm just kidding.
If walls could talk, they wouldn't know half the details that I felt. Secrets and one-sided perspectives kept on the other side of closed doors could not escape me. I was beautiful once. My ancestors grown from the purity of Mary's lamb. Sweet child, I adore you. My kind were taken from their homes too. I was tethered together just like you. I remember the way you used to cry late nights getting your hair braided for Sunday school, rubbing the wetness from your fingertips deep into my skin. Do you remember when you would perform your afternoon chores? I felt your bare feet tiptoeing around the house, sprinkling powder over my surface before grabbing a vacuum. A ballet performed in the living room. Your knees pressed against me. I felt the brush and the water and the all-natural tonics used to keep me clean. You don't dance anymore. Blame it on arthritis. We all grow old. Yesterday, you slipped bringing dinner to the table. I felt your heartbeat. I knew you were thinking about not getting up. If I had hands, I would applaud you for getting back up. I felt the gravy settling into my pores. Your hands no longer nimble with youth. I have another stain. It happens more often now. Your family noticed. Your grandson asked if you would like to have me stripped away and replaced with hardwood. It's supposed to be easier to clean, but it reminds you that you are no longer graceful. I admire you, little one. You know hard floors will not catch you the way I do. I listened to you meditate to Badu. I heard your revelation. A miseducation is still an education. Look at how far you've come. You are not the only one to be synthetically reproduced in whiter and brighter models with plastic and silicone enhancements and passed off as original, or worse, improved. They don't craft us like they used to. This is a new decade. This is a new generation that neither of us are accustomed. They have a new mentality and new customs. The children you raised, raised them. Turn of the century, millennium, and they're changing the way they listen. They don't heed your warnings. But you're not the type to cause friction. Their new colloquialisms convince them that the new pace is lit. But you and I know, when you move too fast in the right direction without the proper footing, it's a quick slip. That's why they call it rug burn. One of the fundamental purposes of life is to live and learn. So you watch them live and leave and grow the way I did you. And then they come back home, cross the threshold without taking off their shoes, bruised egos, teary-eyed and skid knees, and you transform. You become five-star chef, therapist, seamstress of vintage swag? Old school, ain't no fussing when it comes to the tussin, medical assistance, cardiologist to the brokenhearted. It's beautiful, child, the way your hands transform into your mother's. And the way her hands were a blessing passed down from her mother's great, great, great grandmother. I have been there, child, before filters. When a little bleach added to the water was the only form of color correction, your granddaughter posts a selfie of she and you and I become the backdrop. Tom don't fly, she walks, leaving behind stains and scars like foot traffic on carpet or wrinkles on a child's face. Call me ugly, call me a shame, call me the only visible reminder of a well-built foundation in this home we loved. I am the centerpiece of cheap furniture and average lives. Pre-gentrification, post-slavery, you don't pick cotton no more. You pick loose pieces of dirt and popcorn for my skin. Artificial attachments, tell them I'm a timeline or an open books of accidents and misfortune and happiness. I'm a tapestry telling a story left untitled. Oh.
I love the soundscape tonight. I'm almost feeling like this is a chat book that just happened up here tonight. I mean, something that we should explore. Zedeka Poindexter is an Omaha-born and raised artist. She is the first and only woman of color named Omaha City Slam Champion, and was named Best Performance Poet by the Omaha Entertainment Awards in 2015 and 16. As a member of Omaha's Poetry Slam team, she qualified for semifinals at the National Poetry Slam. Only one other team achieved this honor in its 15-year history. Her work is published online with different literary magazines like The New and All Right, Best Love Poems from the 2013 Women of the World Poetry Slam. Zedeka is currently completing a master's degree in communication and working as a teaching artist with the Nebraska Writers Collective. Her performance this evening is inspired by Nick Cave's Untitled Sound Suit. Please welcome Zedeka Poindexter.
How y'all doing? I'm having a blessed evening. I just needed y'all to know that before I get started.
Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to be seen. So I found every color around me, soaked it into my skin, then fashioned it into a bouquet for you. Mm. I just wanted to give you flowers, something I personally harvested. You took them again and again and again until I had no more skin for gifting. And you didn't appreciate it anyway. Mm. No matter how ornate the arrangement, you wrinkled your nose. No matter how bloody fresh the arrangement, you shook your head. No matter how lovingly shaped the arrangement, how earnestly I placed it in your hands, it was always too much of me. Mm. Not enough of whatever it is you actually value. Baby, I still don't know what that is. What color I gotta be? What skin do I need to grow? What external shell do I need to adopt to exist? Don't answer that. I know. It's fine. See, flowers and flesh like mine die so quickly. Temporarily important. Interrupting our life cycle is just for your ego and your adornment. Mm. Discarded when our moment passes. But I, baby, am the master of found things. So when my offerings were lost to you, I refashioned them. It's been a process, growing past the pruning, blooming wide and tall, becoming fragrant and full of myself. This is no longer a gift for you, but baby, you're about to get it. This is now my battle regalia I wear when I want to go, when I go to war to keep loving myself.
Mm, come on.
Watch me move. Mm. Seeding and reseeding the areas I touch with growth you could never understand. Mm. Watch me matter. Mm. Convert the light and air around us to a necessary and magical substances you will never have the language to thank me for. Mm. Watch me thrive. Mm. This garden will loom large, unchecked, resplendent, and outside of your appreciation. Oh, you're gonna see this. Like it or not, it is here. This is my beautiful. These are my flowers.
Yeah! Woo!
I want you by my lord.
church say amen. Mm-hmm. Our last poet of the evening is here intentionally because we always stand on the shoulders of those who paved the way for us. And when we remember that, we can continue to hold the baton and pass it forward to the next generation because we didn't forget who laid the foundation in the past. Our last poet of the evening is none other than Mr. Harry Eure. Now, Mr. Eure wrote a book, and I'm probably not gonna read it all because I want him to get up here and display his work and convey his passion on stage. But I am going to read the beginning portion of it and allow you to read the rest, because this right here is a living legend here in our community, in the African-American oral tradition. He is, I am. Mr. Eure's family has been one of the primary or originators of the Black and African-American cultural arts in Omaha and the Midwest area. In 1969, along with his brothers and parents, I'm not gonna read everybody, they created the first Black theater in Nebraska. And it was called the Afro Academy of the Dramatic Arts Incorporated. And for decades, this historic, prolific theater, cultural arts, educational center, and Eure Productions have produced and presented numerous original and contemporary plays that included music, dance, art, creative writing, and presentations. I could go on and on about Mr. Eure, and there is more on our program. But at this time, ladies and gentlemen, and beautiful beings that are here tonight for this experience, I'd like you to give a warm welcome to Mr. Harry Eure.
Thank you, Felicia.
And tonight, you are working with The Untitled by Legion's painting, Legion, Glenn Legion, Untitled, Malcolm X.
Thank you, Felicia. I want to give her just a brief, and she told me I would do it, just a brief history and a lesson, perhaps a prophecy, a reflection of truth and hypocrisy. There's a compilation of three, maybe four, I threw one in, poems that I'd like to recite for you that transcend our space and time with conflict, agony, stress, frustration, love, death, and dream conflict to rebirth, renaissance, and revolution. The first of those poems I like to recite is entitled Diurnal, or A Young Black Man's Writ of Suicide. The next one will be Color God Black, followed by Good Friday, which was actually written a year to the date of the assassination of Dr. Minister Martin Luther King, 1 year after. I was, I think, 18 or 20, somewhere there. And it happened to be the Easter Good Friday, so I had entitled it Good Friday, question mark. And I will end with an original poem entitled Cross It Out. Diurnal, or Young Black Man's Writ of Suicide. The earth
round the sun. Has my life just begun? The seasons by and by, they make me want to cry. The thrill of the first, the agony of the last, they create sensations never surpassed. The boredom of life, the ecstasy of death, the hopes of the future will never be met. Is life in vain? As a pitter-patter of rain, to be only exalted when Noah came? Oh, common life, show something new as the first blossoms of orchids are so blue. Show me, oh life, before I go, stars of pink, a sky of snow. And dear God, show me life as it was meant to be, without sorrow, pain, tragedy. And me? Color God black, from the soil I have come. Now my black feet walk up on, formed in the reality of a living God, man in God's image of black sod. Why? To walk this now bitter land. Color God black. For you see, perhaps he made his first image the color of me. A year has passed. Now, 50 years have passed, but tears the same of our fallen black hero slain. The dreamer of dreams, he spoke of peace, though concern and love hath not increased. He feared not death, his faith was true. He died for blacks and whites to do. Today, Good Friday, so they say, good for racists as in Jesus' day. Martin Luther King, Christ-like man, crucified and murdered in this land. Martin like Jesus, King like Christ. Forever great men must die twice. Our King, he faced death balcony high, while reverently gazing in the sky. His final thought and wish so bright, saying, "Precious Lord, real good tonight." A legacy of love he left behind. Though left, was it ahead of time? Now, false tributes to our king must go. True honor, not from the lips, but the soul. Let not this day appease their wrong. Redeem his death. Don't just sing sad song. A year has passed. I'm getting old. 50 years have passed. 50 years have passed. But tears the same of our fallen black hero slain. The dreamer of dreams, he spoke of peace. Though concern and love hath not increased, concern and love hath not increased, concern and love hath not increased. Has it? Cross it out. A man declaimed that loving God walked this wretched earth. He healed the sick and raised the dead from a fruitless death to birth. His man-made peers of sin forsake his loving cry. And as they pondered truth, they condemned the truth to die. Cross it out. A man declaimed as the black king whose crown he wore of love died innocently, passive, as his brown eyes looked above. Cross it out. A fierce black tongue, Malcolm Little, damn white devils to die, to find his pious Muslim thought defiled by Elijah's lie. Cross it out. Defy that which destroys your soul and mars you an orphan man, nigger, to rise and touch a ray of sun and brightly say, "I can." Cross it out. Malcolm Little sought the truth in names of hypocrisy, and in his search for self, the same, he saw and he found sin in his own name and crossed it out, did he? Thank you.
That was Mr. Harry Eure. At this time, if all the poets that were a part of this production, please come to the stage. We want to thank you for being here tonight at Vision Verse Voice Being Black in America. If you choose to take a picture, please make sure that you hashtag Vision Verse and Voice Being Black in America, 30 Americans at the Joslyn Art Museum.
you, Joslyn Art Museum. Thank you, Keithro, for keeping our beautiful soundscape. Thank you to the audience for being here tonight. Thank you for each and every one of you dynamic poets, and thank you for your heart, your love, your spirit as we explore 30 Americans.